Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of the AskIoT video series presented by IoT for All, the number one publication and resource for the Internet of Things. I'm your host, Ryan Chacon. If you're watching this on YouTube, we truly appreciate it if you give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel if you have not done so already. All right, on today's episode, we have Steve Statler, the Senior Vice President of Marketing at Wiliot. They are a company that is a leader in battery-free Bluetooth semiconductors and cloud services and focus on scaling the Internet of Things by connecting people and products in new ways. So we're going to talk about and answer the question of what is ambient IoT? What is it? How can you connect things more in a cheaper way? Keys to keeping and making things affordable when it comes to the IoT space. Why does it matter? How does it work? And the future of ambient IoT. Very cool conversation. A lot of you who may have not heard the term ambient IoT before will learn a lot, I think, on this episode with Steve. So please enjoy this episode of the Ask IoT series. Welcome, Steve. Thanks for taking some time to chat with me today. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thank you, Ryan. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, it's great to have you. Very interesting topic that we're going to talk about today. I'm excited for it. But I wanted to kick this off by having you give a quick introduction about yourself, background, any information that would help give our audience some more context as to who to listen to.
Well, my name is Steve Statler, and I run marketing and ESG with a focus on the environment and sustainability part of that mission. So I've been at Wiliot since Q2 of our existence back in 2017.
Fantastic. And for those who may not be familiar, what does Wiliot do? Kind of what role do you play in the space? What areas do you focus on? Those kinds of things.
Well, we're an ambient IoT company, and I think we'll explain a bit more what that means. Mm-hmm. But in terms of what we make and sell, we design and create a chip which powers a postage stamp-sized computer. We call them IoT pixels. Mm-hmm. What we sell is the cloud service that enables that pixel to work. All of our tags can sense temperature, they're encrypted, they're secure, and you use the cloud service to kind of manage access to all of that data. We license everything apart from the cloud service for free, so anyone can make an IoT pixel, anyone can make the Bluetooth compatible devices that are used to read them, and we supply them for a broad range of applications that are bringing the digital and physical worlds closer together.
Fantastic. So to your point, talking about ambient IoT, yes, let's dive into that. First thing, high level for our audience, what does ambient IoT mean? Let's take it from there.
I think we all have a sense of what the word ambient means. You look it up in the dictionary and it means something that is everywhere that surrounds you. And up until now, IoT has really been the internet of expensive things. And what we're doing is by having a battery-free postage stamp size source of intelligence and connectivity and sensing, secure communications, we can start to put the intelligence and computing into everyday things that surround us. So in particular, packaging for food and medicine into clothing, even into furniture. And so this vision of extending the aperture that separates the digital and physical worlds so that you get the full force of the internet applied to the fabric of everything around us is what we enable. And at a practical level, some of the early applications are around supply chain inventory management and giving retailers and product manufacturers kind of an omniscient real-time view of where everything is and what state it's in and whether it's being used.
So has ambient IoT kind of that approach and kind of the ability to connect more things around us and bring that all into the fold of connecting the digital and physical world, it seems like parts of that or elements of IoT in the daily life has not always been plausible. We talk about IoT solutions a lot on here, and it's usually around bigger, when it comes to asset tracking, for instance, bigger, very expensive assets and being able to track and monitor them. But it really hasn't gotten into the kind of daily fabric of what we do or every day for us as just individuals. What have been the biggest enablers of ambient IoT in your mind?
Well, I think one of the key things is getting the size and cost and maintainability of this edge node to, you know, really scalable proportions. So our sometimes people call what we make a tag. So our product costs less than 10 cents. So if you think about the evolution of computing from mainframes that cost millions of dollars, we sold thousands of those. Then that gave way to desktops that cost thousands, and we sold millions of those. Then there were billions of smartphones. And now we're seeing at a much more affordable price point, the prospect of trillions of these connected ambient IoT sensors. But it's also the infrastructure. In the past, probably the closest thing to the scale of what we're talking about has been RFID, and that required scanners and readers that cost thousands of dollars. So we're talking about infrastructure here because it's based around Bluetooth. The cost is 100 times lower. And that means that you can have omnipresent reading of everything in real time that doesn't require manual intervention. There's no tapping or scanning. It's just the readers and the infrastructure everywhere so that you get this continuous view. So it's a combination of things, technology, evolution, and our ability to dispense with the battery and get the form factor down to something that can be made and actually integrated into other products. When you don't have a battery, then you can start to embed this sensing and connectivity into the cardboard box, into the plastic, into the fabric of the things that surround us.
Tell us or walk us through a few different use cases just so people can kind of connect the dots as to actually how this works outside of, you know, the maybe things that they kind of that catch most of their attention. But when we're talking about ambient IoT, what are some of the leading use cases that not just you all focus on, but have just kind of seen kind of lead the way?
Well, for those people who can catch the video of this, then this is what an IoT pixel looks like. So literally the size of a postage stamp. But these devices can get smaller. So one of the early projects that we did during COVID was this, where we were, and I'm holding up a tiny vaccine vial. And for those with ultra keen eyes or a good imagination, if you're listening, then you can see an antenna in there. So that proved the ability to track and authenticate a vaccine vial. This is the real thing. This is the temperature. Yep. This is the fill level. This is the dilution. So that's kind of a cutting edge use case. To really answer your question, the thing that's taking off is attaching these IoT pixels to reusable containers, to crates, plastic crates, and pallets that are used to transport food, because there's such a high level of waste between the farm and the store, 40%, according to the UN. So if you can see where things are, what the temperature is, when things are being left in the wrong place at the wrong time, you can put days of shelf life onto produce. So that's the thing that's really scaling. And then the second thing is real-time inventory in stores. COVID has taught everyone to shop online. And so if you're going to survive in the grocery world, in many retail worlds, you have to support omnichannel, this concept of people buying online, picking up in store, buying online, having it delivered. If you don't have really great inventory accuracy, life becomes very difficult in that world. And so that's the other big driver of adoption of this technology at the moment.
Fantastic. So just to give a little bit more, I guess, clarity on the main difference between kind of ambient IoT and other types of, I guess, larger IoT projects that are maybe tracking larger devices, require lots of battery power, different kinds of connectivity. What really, in your mind, kind of sets this apart so that people can understand and really understand why this is so important and why this matters so much?
I mean, why it matters is the scale of the problems that we have to solve. If you think about what we face, then supply chain disruption is impacts us. It's driving inflation. It's driving all sorts of issues. But climate change is probably an even more existential issue. And we can use this technology to fight climate change in three ways. One is having a real-time view of carbon footprint rather than an annual assessment. If you're tagging all your assets, you can do that. That allows you to empower and measure the whole organization rather than just having some exec carrying the bad news, making supply chains more efficient, existing supply chains. And then the third thing is moving from supply chains to demand chains, which is where manufacturers can see, get demand signals from the store and even from the home. And if they can see, if a manufacturer can see the inventory levels of their product on the shelves and they can see the product being consumed, then you can radically improve the efficiency with which that supply chain is served. And that can make a huge difference in the fight against climate change, but it also can make a huge difference in terms of profits and other key metrics.
And what do you see some of the other leading kind of, or I guess future use cases and industries that Ambient IoT will really play a role in kind of taking kind of forward to the next steps?
Well, I think it will transform all industries. Healthcare is a key one because the stakes and the costs are so high. So imagine you have computing and sensing built into every medication delivery system, whether it's a blister pack or a pill bottle, and you can tell, well, first of all, prove that it's the real thing. Then you can see when it's being used. There's a huge amount of waste in the healthcare system with people not adhering to the regimen that's been prescribed. And very often that's because they forget. But certainly if they don't take their meds, then the doctor needs to know because, you know, switching to another course of drugs is not going to make any difference if you're not taking the ones that were prescribed elsewhere. So that's medication, and there's innumerable use cases in that space that impact cost and efficacy, especially when you're starting to distribute things like vaccines, knowing where everything is, being able to load balance, super important. But clothing is another area where there's massive pollution and waste and issues. And many of us have a desire to see that move to a more circular economic system where clothing can be reused, it can be rented, and having connectivity enables all sorts of really amazing new ways of distributing and building businesses around fashion and apparel.
Fantastic. And outside of use cases and kind of industries we see Ambient IoT kind of getting into to help grow, what are some of the other things we should be looking forward to kind of in the Ambient IoT space? What's the future of the space look like in your mind? And just kind of, I guess, we kind of finish off there.
Yeah, well, the good thing is, whilst Wiliot has a lead in this area, there's plenty of other companies that are following on. So I think there'll be more and more choice, and that will be good because there's so many use cases, and one company can only serve, you know, it can't serve all of them. And one of the things that I think is going to help accelerate that and allow the market to mature faster is standards. So 3GPP, which is the standards body that defines 3G, 4G, 5G, and 6G, has decided that the future releases of 5G and then 6G will embody and support Ambient IoT. And so I think that will be a catalyst for a huge wave of vendors and service providers, solution providers entering this area. And we see IEEE doing something similar. And Bluetooth already have a head start in this area because, you know, we're using their protocol. So I think we'll see some healthy competition and some standards that will just reduce the friction and accelerate the adoption. So what I would say is now is a really good time to start thinking strategically about what does this mean to our business? Is my infrastructure in the right shape to support suddenly everything being connected? And then looking for places to get some experience and start off small and build some knowledge within the organization about how to progress.
Fantastic. Well, very interesting topic. I think our audience is going to get a ton of value out of this. What's the best way for them to follow up, to learn more, not just about what you all do at Wiliot, but at the same time, questions from this conversation, learn more about what Ambient IoT is, how it could potentially benefit the industry that they play in, and just kind of engage further after this conversation? What's the best way they can do that?
Well, If you go to our website, there's free training. There's a Wiliot 101 online course, which you can do to get up to speed. There are some kits that you can use to actually experiment hands-on. Today, we dropped the price of our starter kit from $500 to $150. So you can actually get some IoT pixels and the hardware that's required to energize and read them and play with them. And then, you know, talk to solution providers. We're a platform. We don't do applications, even though we focus on markets. And so yep. Talk to your system integrator, your current suppliers, and get them to join in the conversation. We'd love to support an ecosystem. That's what we're doing.
Fantastic. Well, Steve, thank you so much for your time. Fascinating stuff that you all have going on. I'm very excited to kind of see how this continues to grow and progress and move a lot of the different industries that you talked about forward. It's going to be great when we can start to connect even more things that a lot of people didn't really think were possible or made sense from an ROI perspective, especially on an affordability standpoint. So I think what you all are doing is great, and appreciate you taking the time to kind of educate our audience on this space and kind of and what it's going to enable now and into the future.
Well, education is key to all of this. So Ryan, I appreciate your giving us this ability to get the word out and the broader education that you're doing. It's really important.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, I thought it was great, and look forward to doing more content together. And other than that, you know, we appreciate your time and hope to talk again soon.
Very good. Take care.
All right, everyone. Thanks again for watching that episode of the Ask IoT video series. I hope you found a lot of value in it. If you did, please be sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel. It helps others find it and make sure that you get the latest episodes as soon as they come available. Other than that, if you have any questions or topics that you would like us to cover in this series, please leave them in the comments or shoot us an email at hello@iotforall.com. Other than that, thanks again for listening, and we'll see you next time.